Hey, Greg, today I was thinking back to childhood and when I used to think that I could just walk up to the end of the world and very carefully peek over the ledge. I remember voicing this to a teacher and her saying that it's impossible because the earth is round and you would just keep going and going with no end in sight. And with a slight amount of hesitation, I just tossed the impossible away. I gave up dreams for science. I traded the possibility of hang gliding off the end of the earth for walking forever. I'm not saying I believe in a flat earth. I mean, it's possible. What do I know? I know I can't seem to find any information on anyone flying a plane from north to south ever. What I am saying, though, is that we shouldn't be so easy to take dreams from each other. There has to be a happy medium for this, right? Are we all so riddled with impossibilities down to our core that we feel the need to let it flow through us, letting it overcome us and then spread? We are all so impressionable as children, and the ones that taught my generation didn't even have the knowledge they are teaching us available when they were in their impressionable ages. We can dream no more. We cannot believe in the impossible. Have we overlooked something detrimental to what it is to be human? Are we missing a key part of the human experience? Knowledge is power? Well, I ask who? Who wanted power? It's thought-provoking to consider that science has ruined us. I think of all the bad that has come from scientific discoveries and then try to outweigh it with all the good, and still I am lost. I just keep walking and walking, trying to find answers because I had my dreams taken away from me as a child.
The planet's puppet masters almost surely have a plan. There's clearly maybe something there beyond the realm of man. And until you've thoroughly tested every last close trusted view, I find the more you think you know, the less you really do.
That's true, Dr. Zayas.
Where would we be without THC? Cause we know they're lying to us, just don't know to what degree. Yeah, where would we be without THC? The Higher Side Chat Show, Greg Carwood and Company.
Holy hell, Higher Side Chatters, drinking a little drink, smoking a little smoke, and thoroughly enjoying the frequencies they don't want you to know about. From sunny San Diego, I'm Greg Carwood. And as we ride the waves of the vast conspiracy, we find our attention shifting from one nefarious group to another, weighing their influence and their reach against the others, on a quest to pinpoint the ultimate oppressors and release ourselves from their reality-crafting clutches. It's a tough row to hoe, no doubt, and each layer of the oppression onion can take a lifetime in itself to unpeel. And it can seem a bit daunting when we have to relearn humanity's history, re-examine settled science, and explore the unknown levels of consciousness without much guidance and a whole heap of resistance. Our picture might never be perfect, but as we spend more time with those willing to do the dirty work, the fog begins to lift. Now, any THC listener knows I try to run a fairly faith-free show, but religious themes are so interlinked with humanity's history, our war-torn past, and the belief systems of the elite, its occasional popping up is nearly inevitable. And just as a person can put blinders on to avoid uncomfortable truths that challenge their own cozy paradigm, the knife can cut the other way as well. These are the kind of things we have to weigh individually when deciding where the pieces fit into our own puzzles. For example, last week's guest didn't want to point the finger at the Vatican because of his Catholic beliefs, and so today I have a guest who makes the case that not only is the Vatican worthy of the attention of any truth seeker set on pinning down the big pyramid, but the Vatican Power Center and their own under-the-radar order known as the Jesuits, or the Society of Jesus, might just be the apex predator of the elusive power pyramid, the wizards behind the curtain and the hidden hand of Hades, pushing the blame off onto scapegoats at every turn. Now, I will say today's guest, Johnny Cirucci, comes from a Christian perspective, which everyone knows I'm not a huge fan of, but I really like the guy. And I think anyone can appreciate the work he's done. And I don't want to reject good information about the elite because of my own hang-ups on fairly unrelated issues. He's also familiar with THC and my hostile attitude towards some of his beliefs, and he still came on anyway, and that's a classy move. But what's really important is you'll hear about connections and elite family names that you might never have heard of. And I think Johnny packs in so much information into each answer that it's pretty impressive. And he was kind enough to stick around for what's almost a 3-hour episode, so while we do spend some time butting heads on this faith-based perspective, it doesn't take away from the conspiratorial material because we stayed until my questions were pretty much done, which not every guest is willing to do. There are listeners who have asked me to have a true Christian on, and I'm not exactly sure what they mean by that, but I think Johnny will fit the bill. And for my people who are sick of religion talk, I am right there with you, and the pendulum will swing back the other way. I even said this to Johnny in the show, but I don't see how you can have 100% faith in Christianity when you acknowledge that the Vatican and Catholicism is a mind control machine. Because I see them as so similar, especially in the control mechanisms that I think are built into the man in the sky, heaven or hell paradigm. But with that said, on the other hand, you can see how it might take someone like Johnny, a diehard Christian, to do this level of detailed work into Catholicism, the Vatican, and the Jesuits. He has a personal interest because it's given his faith a bad name. I get that. Might he give them too much credit because of that? Maybe. You have to decide. But they damn sure aren't innocent. So while Johnny and I don't agree on the nature of reality, how we got here, and what happens when we die, we can both agree that certain trappings of religion have done a large amount of damage to the people, and the Vatican has ruthlessly risen to a power position few can say they've occupied. That is key, and let this be an example that we can have major differences, discuss them, but ultimately realize we have a common enemy, and it's not people of other faiths, it's not immigrants crossing the imaginary line to feed their families, it's not refugees, black people, the gays, or the poor. It is the oppressors at the top. It's the people with the resources and the desire to do real damage. And anytime we forget that, and the struggles of other people who might be different against our same common enemies, we just erode humanity's progress and give the hidden hands another reason to applaud themselves. So let's knock that off. So everyone join hands in a chorus of Kumbaya, and let's get this party started with the man of the hour, Johnny Cirucci. Enjoy. Alright folks, we know things aren't right. Many of us wake up to the sound of someone else's bell, schlep off to someone else's business, and spend our days as a cog in someone else's machine. We're relegated to energy sources, food, and medicines that are easy to control by the nefarious few, and our media, education, and history books have been carefully crafted to remind you there's nothing to see here. But we know better, and while we watch our reality being conjured up around us, to really identify those shadowy puppet masters can be a difficult task. We've heard guests make their case for the top of the pile being everyone from the Freemasons to the Jewish banking families to the Archons to the Triple Crown Control. But today's guest is shining his spotlight on a guilty party you might not be too familiar with, and that might be the first clue that he's right. His name is Johnny Cirucci, the prominent host behind Resistance Rising Radio and the prolific author of the hefty 800-page powerhouse that is Illuminati Unmasked, everything you need to know about the New World Order and how to beat it, shining that spotlight where few people dare to go. Johnny, my man, welcome to THC.
Greg, I'm smiling behind the microphone because I'm so excited to be here. I really appreciate it.
Good to hear it, man. I'm psyched for this too. I've heard whispers over the years about the Jesuit order, but never a whole lot of details. And when I heard about your research, I knew it'd make a good show that deviates from the same old storyline a bit. But I don't think everyone is going to have a clear understanding of who the Jesuits really are, which, of course, could probably be by design. But let's clarify this out of the gate so people really know exactly what you mean.
We can clarify it, and I'll give a grabber right off the bat. Whenever the title of my book, Illuminati Unmasked, if anyone were to mention, I know as we surf the internet in search of truth, you find a lot of hosts and a lot of channels want to use the word Illuminati to pull in viewers and listeners.
Right.
Illuminati symbolism, ex-Illuminati, anything you could think of. Illuminati playing cards, it's all out there. There is a connection between the Illuminati and this group of people that I am convinced is at the top of the pyramid that is pretty astounding, and to the point where if someone mentions the word Illuminati and doesn't mention this group organization, I'm convinced that they're either criminally negligent on their subject matter or work for the same group. So that as a teaser and lead in to the question, answer your question, who are the Jesuits? I promised you that I would declare my bias to your audience right off the bat. I am a born-again Christian. I've been born again since 1994. I absolutely understand that you do not have necessarily a predominantly Christian audience, so I'm sensitive to that. Just want the audience to know that that is my bias. Those are the glasses that I wear when I look at things.
Sure.
But I am absolutely a true seeker, Greg. And as a true seeker, I've found, and thanks to your show and broaching the so many important topics about our environment, our matrix, whether the earth is round or flat, I mean, really important topics. What we found as truth seekers is that we have to be our own scientists. We have to employ empiricism because we've been lied to so bloody much, Greg, that simply accepting what archaeologists or NASA or the government or the media tells us just doesn't work.
Right.
It guarantees that you're going to be given misinformation. And so we have to be our own scientists, and that means employing the scientific method. You have to make an observation and couch or create an hypothesis as a result of the observation, isolate the variables, see if you can conduct an experiment to replicate your observation, and then say, hey, I've been able to replicate the observation, and therefore there's a pretty good chance my hypothesis is correct. And I mention that because when I get into this topic, there's a lot of spiritual subject matter, but at the base of it, we're still all scientists. So I absolutely like to deal in names, places, and dates. That's why the book has 2,000 citations, because you get into subject matter and people say, oh, you know, that's just your opinion, you're crazy, you're a conspiracy theorist, or whatnot. But the reality is that when it comes to control, and that's what you and I are after, Greg, we're after, why does it feel like we're slaves and we don't know it? Why is that the movie The Matrix such a powerful teacher to us, that the ultimate slavery, the ultimate enslavement, is the one you're not aware of?
Amen.
And so in digging into what are the methods of enslavement, I found that certainly religion, not necessarily faith or beliefs, but religion is one of the most powerful enslaving forces to humanity. And again, I'm saying this as a born again Christian, but it's the tenets of religion. It's when you surrender your will and unfortunately even your intellect to a human hierarchy. And my understanding of what it means to be a Christian is to do away with that. So that's why I'm saying that as a Christian, is that religion is the most powerful force of enslavement, can make people do things that they wouldn't normally do. And that's what breaks us down to who is at the top of the world power and what are they behind. Historically, again, a few of the historical aspects of my own Christian faith is, we believe that Jesus Christ was a real person. Jesus of Nazareth died on a cross. He was the Son of God. Fully God, fully man. And so we as Christians believe that when he died on the cross, it was an amazing event. It freed us from religion, the religion of Judaism, the religion of obeying the Judaic laws, the Mosaic laws, in order to not feel guilt and to be freed from sin and so forth. So really prior to that, even if you just look at the historical Jesus, you can make a case for a combination of Jewish and Roman hierarchy as being the ones that put an end to the Christian uprising, the Jesus uprising, because it was a threat to religious authorities.
Mm-hmm.
Because religion and the religious authorities had wielded such amazing control over people, over humanity. And when they saw this upstart saying, hey, you don't need religion anymore, you just need a relationship with me, that was extremely dangerous. And so we as Christians believe that Christ freed us from those bonds of religion. And boy, within 500 years, there was an amazing, and this is historical fact, that the changes that occurred within the Roman Empire were powerful. Of course, Rome at the time of the life of Jesus Christ, whether you believe him as historical or not, was the most powerful empire in the world, controlled the known world, and was starting to wane within 200 years after that. And by 300 years, there were some conversions. There was a split to the Roman Empire, the Byzantine Empire, and the Christian sect, which is really considered an offshoot of Judaism, was heavily persecuted. We're all familiar with the aberrations, abominations of Nero, of covering Christians with pitch and using them to light his gardens. The Christians in the Colosseum, you know, being thrown to wild animals and lions and so forth. So, and it didn't stop the faith. Obviously, it didn't stop the Christians from being Christians. It actually helped them to grow and expand. And so, we have the advent of Emperor Constantine, who supposedly had this vision of seeing a symbol, a Christian symbol. It could be the Cairo. We're not really sure, but the Cairo is what and soldiers put on their shields, supposedly according to Constantine's instructions. He was told in this vision, by this sign shall you conquer. And at this time, the Roman Empire was split. There were many factions, and this was at the Battle of Milvian Bridge, where Constantine did win. And within a few short years, he had coalesced his power to become Roman Emperor. And you know, we can say what we want about whether or not his vision was legitimate. He enacted some amazing reforms. He immediately stopped persecution of Christians. He stopped child sacrifice. He stopped many slavery abuses. And so these reforms really mark Constantine as either a convert or someone who is really politically savvy. I'm really, previous to this, the emperors were considered gods, mm-hmm. and could do any abuse that they wanted and did. And unfortunately, it was very poisonous to the empire. But Constantine's reforms were powerful and worked to his favor. And so as a result, he's marked in history as a seminal figure. Now, many people get him confused with a later emperor, some five emperors later, I think 10 years or so, Theodosius. Now, Theodosius is the one who made Christianity. He figured he'd take Constantine's reforms to the next level. Theodosius is the one who made Christianity the state religion of the Roman Empire. Now, that's something rather different, because the Roman Empire was a pagan empire based on a menagerie of gods that can trace its roots back through Greece, Egypt, all the way back to Babylon and Chaldea. So what happens, Greg, with all of these gods and beliefs when all of a sudden you're commanded to be Christian? Well, you have a lot of insincere conversions. Mm-hmm. And so the result is a syncretistic mix of all of those beliefs. And unfortunately, I know there are 1.2 billion Catholics. When I mention this stuff, I don't want to alienate any of our Catholics. There are some great Catholics in my family. Mm-hmm. I'm Italian, so that's my background. I just want to know, let them to know that the historical background of their faith, it has these roots, these origins of this mixing as a result of Roman authority, of Babylonian and Greco paganism with Christian beliefs. And unfortunately, that's kind of where we're at with Roman Catholicism today. But that's not the issue as far as leadership and power. It just is the roots of the return of religion and the chains that bind human beings. Again, there's no greater binding, Greg, than what's in your own mind. Mm-hmm. And if you are convinced that your guilt, the guilt that you feel from your daily living and from what you understand as what's wrong versus, you know, sin, those things bind you down. You're told that there is a human hierarchy, a priesthood that can release you from that. Then, well, boy, there's no more powerful force there.
Right.
And you might even have created conventions such as the idea of, when you die, of course, there's no way to verify this. When you die, you don't go to your judgment. You go into a place of holding, and we'll call this purgatory. And while you're in purgatory, you're waiting for what you're supposed to be receiving, your judgment. Now, we on the outside have the ability to release you from purgatory. And if you give us a nice donation, we'll do that. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, brother, that works. If you don't know any better, that can be extremely powerful and painful.
Yeah.
And those are known as indulgences. And those were some of the things that the Catholic religion practiced at the time. And we'll pick back up at Theodosius after he forced Christianity to become the state religion of the Roman Empire. By 500 AD, you now had a conversion, a breakdown of the Roman Empire, and a conversion into the Holy Roman Empire, where we have the Bishop of Rome taking on the mantle of being the vicar of Christ on earth. That certainly may not have been that strong an assertion in 500 AD, but within a few centuries, that's exactly what it was, to a perversion to the point where we now have the modern Bishop of Rome, the Pope, when he speaks ex cathedra, he speaks on behalf of God as God, and papal concordants that are written ex cathedra, do you know, they actually capitalize the pronoun. When the Pope writes, he writes with a capital H when he says he, and he's talking mm-hmm. about himself. Mm-hmm. So, wow, that is extremely powerful. So now you have these abuses that start to occur as a result of the chains and the bonds of religion coming back on people who want to be Christians, from indulgences to being excommunicated. It's extremely powerful. The kings around the world that were manipulated to do what papal authorities said under just the threat of excommunication.
Right.
Wow. Really powerful.
Yeah.
You have now a religious authority growing in Rome, the conversion into the Holy Roman Empire, of being extremely powerful, king maker. Now, what had occurred as a result of many of these abuses, of course, another tenet of Roman Catholicism is requiring leadership to the priesthood to be celibate.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's not an easy thing.
No.
And as a result of this requirement, the vast majority of people that enter into the priesthood struggle with this. And unfortunately, there are many many crimes that are committed and have been committed from the very beginning.
Right.
It could be something as seemingly innocuous as simply two consenting adults, a priest having relations with a woman, and it could devolve much worse into that. And we all know that it has devolved into much worse, the abuse of children. It is not a basic, it is really a Catholic tenet that you must confess your sins to Catholic hierarchy versus a Protestant or Christian tenet that says you confess your sins by yourself to Christ. And the confessional has also been terribly abused in not just these incidents of child sex abuse, but just in intelligence gathering, where you think that what you say to a priest is safe, but in reality, he's writing it down and he's giving it to his church hierarchy.
Mm-hmm.
And so after these abuses cropped up, hey, we started to have people that were bucking the system. And unfortunately, with the power that Rome wielded, men who bucked the system weren't treated well. You look back on those who tried to protest the abuses of the Catholic Church, and many of them were burned at the stake.
Mm-hmm.
You go back from John Wycliffe. He wasn't burned at the stake, but Wycliffe tried to protest the abuses of the church. He managed to live to where he had two separate strokes that took his life, but afterwards, within 40 years, the Catholic Church dug up his bones and desecrated them.
Jeez.
There were more, like William Tyndale, who, a good English protester, he was given mercy. He was supposed to be burned to the stake, and instead they strangled him first and then burned him at the stake. And that was considered merciful, because really many of those who protested against the church were just simply burned alive.
Mm-hmm.
The Inquisition, the office of the Inquisition, dealt with people that went against the Catholic Church. And this was both political and religious. So you could have a political problem with the Catholic Church and you could still be on the wrong side. You could be an enemy of the Catholic Church. And as a result, these protests began to be more and more pronounced. And it was a matter of these indulgences buying spiritual favors that was the ultimate problem for a young, was he Franciscan priest? I believe Martin Luther, the Cappuccino Franciscan, I believe. Anyway, he was a Catholic priest and he had a Roman Catholic bishop named John Tetzel, who was going through Wittenberg in Germany and selling indulgences because the Pope, who at the time, hey, tactical pause, we all know about the Rothschilds, Greg.
Right.
But I think that's because we're allowed to know about the Rothschilds. The real power families we've never heard of. And I love your introduction to this show. Who's at the top? Whoever's at the top controls the resources and therefore has the power to make themselves invisible. We've heard of Rothschild. Have we heard of De Medici? Have we heard of Orsini, Aldo Brandini, or Breakspeare? These are the real power families that go back through time. A De Medici was the Pope. I believe it was Leo X at the time of Martin Luther's confrontation of John Tetzel and over indulgences. And it was a De Medici that was trying to build St. Peter's Basilica and to use Michelangelo to paint his frescoes across. So he's building this magnificent edifice and had no money. Or was running out of money because it was that darn expensive. And so what was he doing? He was selling indulgences, which is to give comfort to poor people about their sins and the sins of their family and the sins of their deceased family. And so this young Catholic priest, Martin Luther, was very upset by this. And it was clear exploitation as far as he was concerned. And so he wrote a list of 95 theses, and many people don't know that his 95 theses dealt solely with this indulgences, with the abuse of indulgences. And he really had only intended, when he posted them on the door of All Saints Cathedral in Wittenberg, to really just be an academic discussion. But unfortunately for him, he was a very popular teacher. Some of his students got a hold of, and he originally wrote his 95 theses in Latin, probably to keep himself insulated from getting in too much trouble. But unfortunately for him, as I said, he was a popular teacher. His students got hold of the theses and quickly translated them into German and promulgated them throughout Wittenberg. So none of his comrades came to discuss this issue, but he soon became world renowned as someone making a statement against church hierarchy. And as a result, he was called before papal authorities in Worms, and a congregation of papal authorities is interestingly called a diet. And so we have this Diet of Worms in Germany where he was confronted with this. And at first he was pretty scared, and you would be. I mean, this is the authority that rules the world. The authority has the ability to execute you and to do it in some pretty darn painful ways too. But the church authorities eventually, with their constant demands that he recants everything, got him to dig in his heels, and with Prince Frederick's help, he kind of kidnapped him and kept him safe in Germany, were able to keep this protest alive. And it was the shot heard well around the world, Greg, because the Catholic Church had been abusing its position as the premier religious authority. They were, like I said earlier, king makers, especially in nations that were predominantly Catholic, France, Spain, Italy, owned by the papacy. You did what the Pope told you, or just the threat of excommunication. You're terrified.
Right.
You know, the holding of your sins. These are authorities. They say, and you believed them at the time, that they have the ability to withhold your sins and damn your soul. So these are extremely powerful chains that were binding people. And you have this upstart, these protesters that are saying, wait a minute, this is not how Christianity is supposed to be. And I will say, as another rabbit hole, that as people go back through history and mention abuses, Christian abuses, They mention things like the Crusades and the Inquisition. They're really not talking about Christian abuses. They're talking about Roman Catholic abuses, and those are separate topics.
That's true.
And these were topics that came up at the time in 1534. 1517 is when Martin Luther nailed his 95 Theses to Wittenberg All Saints Cathedral there. And so there were protests throughout Europe at the time, but this, for some reason, was the match that lit the flame. Mm-hmm. And the protest against Roman Catholic abuses just caught like wildfire. And something else is that Christians, rather than relying on priests, they were told at the time, hey, if you want to know anything about your faith, you ask a priest. Well, what about the Holy Scriptures? Those Holy Scriptures were kept in Latin and under lock and key, and you were not allowed to read them,
right?
Or you were not allowed to translate them. That was why Tyndale was executed, is because he had the temerity to translate the Latin Scriptures into his native English tongue.
So let me ask you a question here, because this is all great background and shows how the Roman Catholic Empire ruled with an iron fist and full spectrum dominance. And of course, I do want to get into some of the more modern examples of how this power center still operates. But while we are talking about the religious context and your perspective as a Christian, because you can't get away from it, clearly, just from what you've said already, religion and history, very intertwined. And I guess to summarize, you consider the Vatican and Catholicism to be like a kind of Trojan horse of Christianity, a parasite that kind of warped it from the inside and has used it to control the masses. Is that fair to say?
Bingo. In a nutshell? And I can give you some modern examples when you're ready.
Oh, sure. But to address this religion thing a bit, not that I want this to be the whole show, but I do have questions, because I did grow up Catholic and I did find it to be oppressive and something that held me and my peers back in a lot of ways. Making kids feel shameful and guilty about sex, using fear and flat-out lies to get us to behave to their standard. I mean, telling us that marijuana might as well be as bad as meth. Layers and layers of lies. And I really consider these things flirting with the line of child abuse, because as a kid, you just don't know any better, and it took a long time to work this stuff out. And I'm definitely bitter and resentful about a lot of that. And so it would seem that both of us agree on a lot of the problems of Catholicism, but the thing is, I knew a lot of Christians too, and their situations seemed even more oppressive and restrictive and joyless, really. But I don't understand how you can see all of these problems and manipulations that we're talking about and then still have faith in the biblical texts and Jesus and the source material, because to me it's pretty much the same, and it seems a lot more logical to just not get too attached to any of it. I mean, with all the manipulation, doesn't it kind of seem like a catch-22 a little bit?
You bet, brother. And there's a great, great direction to go in. Honestly, it really is a matter of your personal walk. As a Christian, it's really about discipline and self-control, but that discipline and self-control has to come from inside of you. It can't be forced on you. You can be instructed in the methods of discipline and self-control, but you have to understand for yourself the pitfalls of not being disciplined and what the consequences are. You see in these repressive societies, these repressive mini cultures, we have a lot of this here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Mennonites and Quakers who live in these isolated communities as if they're, you know, from another century, another world.
Right. And it's sad for kids who have to grow up in that and then get thrust into the modern world with no context.
Absolutely. I honestly, again, I'm saying this as a born-again Christian. I have an extreme distaste for that lifestyle, for exactly what you said, that it is oppressive to those that don't know any better. If that's your route that you want to take to be personally disciplined, God bless you. You make that decision as an adult and go that route. Isolate yourself. Go live on a mountain if you want to. But the reality is that the world is full of influences that are malignant. And if you don't believe they're malignant, then you got to go ahead and walk forward and have multiple, sex partners, have sex in ways that for Christians, have it outside of marriage, homosexual sex, whatever you want, because you have to learn for yourself that those behaviors, hey, maybe they're not healthy. Or if you think that they're okay for you, then they're okay for you. It's a discipline of the heart. Now, you have, I'm telling you, Greg, I think a lot of people that have made a bad name for Christians have done this in a way that is conspiratorial, because you're looking at them and you're saying, man, you're blatantly hurting our message. You're blatantly hurting. Why would you possibly do that? Unless there are people on the inside paying you to do it, paying you to make an idiot out of yourself, paying you to turn people off to what could be empowering. I like to use, when I talk about the subject, fitness. We all have food and lifestyles that we really enjoy. They are fun. They're enjoyable. Drinking, eating whatever you want. Unfortunately, they're not good for you. Mm-hmm. You can eat at fat. Oh, by the way, conspiracy. How hard is it to eat healthy?
Right.
How expensive is it to eat healthy? So to me, that tells me that there are people in power that want this to happen. It is sadly, sickeningly easy to get sick, to gain weight, to be out of shape. It's everything points you in that direction. You can't help it unless you're extremely keenly aware and you put copious amounts of efforts into eating healthy, balancing your diet with good exercise.
Agreed.
Now, exercise at the time is freaking monotonous and painful. Oh my goodness. I don't know who enjoys exercise except for people that are addicted to it. Yes, yes. But in the long run, it gives you a feedback. It makes you feel better. It makes you sleep better. It makes you you think better. You think more clearly. I like to use this as a metaphor for spiritual discipline as well, for ethical discipline. It may be easy to get involved with many women. It may be easy to get involved with a married woman, but if you're able to maintain your discipline and stay focused and stay loyal to whatever relationship that you're in at the time, you lose that immediate gratification of the thrill. But in the long run, it gives you a peace about yourself that you just don't have otherwise. So that's how I like to compare what it means to be a real Christian as opposed to the guilt-ridden, like the examples you're talking about, Greg. And I'm sorry that your story is very common, sadly
is.
Common.
Yeah, and that's a good analogy too. I do appreciate that. I mean, I guess my attitude is that if there is a God who is going to be our ultimate judge at death, and if he has any kind of empathy, I don't understand how he could look at the state of the world today, the things we're talking about, all the trappings of mainstream religion, all the corruption and manipulation, and say, well, even though you were a good person to the best of your ability in the world you lived in, you're going to go to hell forever because you didn't have the right label and the right faith. I mean, that just seems completely unreasonable to me if there is a God who looks down and sees what we're going through, you know?
Well, the Christian answer to that is that the purpose for our existence is to be, and again, this is the Christian answer, is to be the best friend, the soulmate, the bride of his son, Jesus Christ. Now, that's our purpose. We're set here to basically to mature, to ripen. And unfortunately, the best thing to ripen or mature a human being, and I bet you non-Christians would agree with this, is pain and trial and challenge.
Okay, well, let me ask you a question there, because yes, challenge and pain can precede growth and progress. I agree with that. But doesn't it seem a bit silly for the whole purpose of all of this, this whole physical plane? You know, we're born here, given this magical opportunity to exist three-dimensionally, just to live a modest life of growth through struggle and constant reverence and worship for the entity that set this all up. I mean, it just seems like a meaningless exercise, a meaningless existence, if the point of your short time here is just to discover Jesus and dedicate your life to the Creator, and then you blink and it's over.
Well, that certainly isn't how my life goes. My life goes is more like a relationship. I liken it to a marriage. My faith is very similar. I don't, of course, nobody really worships their spouse, but I don't stay so fixated on my spouse that it's it's unhealthy, but it's an extremely important part of who I am. I'll tell you, when I'm drained, when I'm dragging, when I need advice, when I need help. And unfortunately, my wife is the IT expert. When I need a computer fix, I go to her and I rely on her, and she's my partner. She's someone that I trust to not attack me when I'm vulnerable. And it's very similar to my religious faith. I have a relationship with Jesus Christ that is not the stiff, stuffy, an hour and a half on Sunday morning with a suit and tie and singing bland songs. That's not what my faith is. My faith is a relationship very similar to my marriage. He's always there. I talk to him, ups and downs. And it gives me a peace. I'll tell you, brother, right now I'm in a work situation. I can't do this for a living. So I'm in a work situation. It's very frustrating. It's very upsetting. I don't have a lot of money. And I sit back and I give that up and I say, hey, you're God, you're in control, you're guiding this. It gives me a sense of peace. And I'm telling you, Greg, if it weren't for the peace I received in feeling for sure that my footsteps are being guided and controlled, that I may have been, I don't want to say suicidal, but really, really devastated with my personal life experiences up to this point, because they've been so frustrating, so many dead ends, that if I didn't have a faith that said there is an infinite being that is carefully guiding your footsteps so that this pain that you're experiencing is going to make you a better person.
Okay, I'm sorry, but let me interject here again real quick, because what you're saying is a common thing that I hear from Christians, but it's also similar to the Buddhist philosophy that life is suffering. But from my perspective, this subtext to everything that happens in life being part of God's plan, to me, it seems like a mechanism man created just to get people to accept poverty and inequality and a shitty position in life. You know, we don't need to end poverty because that's what God wants. We don't know why, but he does. You know, it just seems convenient for a greedy elite to put these thoughts in people's heads that cause them to not work quite as hard as they might otherwise, because they rationalize that they got this real life that they're going to get where everything's great forever and Jesus has their back, even if this life is basically terrible. You got to see why I think that's something that holds people down and kind of serves the elite, right?
Yes, it can be. It can be. That's if you don't understand your responsibility. That's the type of mindset for a very, very immature Christian. The proper mindset is a mindset of stewardship and responsibility. And married people understand this. Parents understand this. As a child, you can say, oh man, this homework is I don't want to touch this. You know what? My dad does my homework. I'm going to leave this up to my dad. I'm not going to worry about this. I'm not going to learn anything. I'm not going to bother with this. I'm going to go play and just have not a care in the world. That's extremely immature, and most good parents will say, I'm not doing your homework for you. It's the same thing in regards to stewardship. There is an important parable, the parable of the talents, of all things, where that Jesus talks about how those who did not watch and maintain before the master came back was dealt with very severely. Here I am, Greg, trying to let people know about the malignant elite and what it is they're doing. And I'll tell you, there are also Christians, and I believe, honestly, many of them are co-opted and controlled by these same powers, who have these doctrines that have been created by Roman Catholicism, by the Jesuits. We'll talk about the Jesuits, who they are, shortly. Mm-hmm. And doctrines that say you don't have to do anything as a Christian because you're going to be beamed up and raptured before any of the bad stuff happens. And now that comes directly from Rome. Those are Jesuit and Catholic doctrines, and they are not what it means to be a Christian. As we get into this, and I mentioned this in my book, whether you've gotten to it yet or not, about some of the evils that occur in the world, such as child sex slavery, mm-hmm. and human trafficking, such as, excuse me, the use of narcotics trafficking to fund these efforts. It is well known within our community that Western intelligence runs off of trafficking cocaine. The CIA in particular. The CIA have done it so much that we now call them the Cocaine Importation Agency. How in the world do you get away with that? You go back to the Nebraska, Omaha, Nebraska child sex slavery scandal that outed itself.
Yes, the Franklin scandal. Some call it
the Franklin cover-up. Yeah,
right.
Because the Franklin Federal Credit Union and Lawrence King was centered on. And by the way, the epicenter of that was Boys Town, a Catholic home for boys. We don't know that because that's been erased from that part of the Franklin cover-up. But if you understand, if you read Kathy O'Brien, if you've read Bryce Taylor, whose real name is Sue Ford. Oh, my goodness, Greg. Are you kidding me? Our own intelligence agency is torturing people, controlling their minds, and turning them into sex slaves? Are you kidding? How could you possibly be a Christian and not be infuriated by that and not say, I'm going to do everything in my power to put an end to it? At the bare minimum, this is what I tell people, Greg, covers over into prepping. The advice I give people as far as prepping goes. Listen, you may be powerless as much as you can sense. You don't have the ability to change who's president, but you do have the ability to protect and look after your family. Perhaps you might be well off. Perhaps you might be upper middle class. Then you might have the ability to make a difference in your township and your community. You have been blessed and gifted with whatever resources you have. Make the best use of them. If you only have enough to prep for 2 weeks, then by Jiminy, you better prep for 2 weeks. We're approaching it a snowstorm. At the bare minimum here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, you common citizens, a good steward, as someone who knows what their responsibility is, hey, you got some food, some dry stores, toilet paper, and fresh water for a couple of days. Common sense. Go beyond that and protect what it is that you have the ability to protect. If you have knowledge, you want to share that knowledge, wake people up, start a blog, start a podcast, and do what you can to wake people up. That is your responsibility. And so this idea that Christians just have to sit back and use their religion as an opiate to mimic Karl Marx, who is, by the way, a Jesuit puppet, you are in for a rude awakening. No parent wants their child to sit around and be lazy. Their parent, and I say this as a metaphor for how Christ and our Christian God is looking down at Christians, you need to be off your rear end and moving and doing what is right and doing the best you can in regards to these topics. If there is abuse going on around the world, you are not allowed. Once you're exposed to this information, I got news for you. You're going to be judged on this. You can't go back and say, oh, no, I want the blue pill now. I'm going to go back in the matrix and make me someone on Wall Street. No, it doesn't work that way. You've been exposed. You're now responsible for this information. You can pretend you don't know it. It can shock you. It can scare you. But guess what? You still know it. And if you keep it to yourself and you don't let the people around you who are being hurt by this information know what's going on, their blood is on your hands. And by the way, that's also in the Bible. It's the requirement of the watchman on the wall. Mm-hmm. I think it's Ezekiel 33, where prophets are told by God, if you have this information and you don't give it to your friends, your brothers, your sisters, people around you, their blood is on your hands. So long and short of it is, Greg, you don't have the ability as a Christian to step back and sit back and allow this stuff to go on.
Right. Well, I do appreciate that. But I would just say, as a member of the human family, you should be outraged about a lot of this stuff. I don't think you need to be a Christian to be upset about what's going on and what the elite have done. You know, I do hear that insinuation a lot, too. But still, I'm just as bothered by these things. And I'm trying to do my part in the information war without any of this coming from a Christian place.
But if you feel like you feel like you're alone, Greg, and it's really easy to co-opt you, to jump in on you, to interrupt your phone conversations, to let you know you're being watched, to have someone sit outside your house, to have something, this happened to me, to have a hole blown in your power phone, telephone pole outside your house, looked like a laser did it, but I don't know what did it. Probably just feedback from the power feedback. To have appliances in your house get fried, costing you hundreds of dollars you can't replace. You have that stuff. Is that going to shake you up? Is that going to scare you? You're going to stop what you're doing, or you're going to drive on and do what you're supposed to do and do the right thing. We talked about this before we started the show. You have a program. You have advertisers. They're suddenly very lucrative. You've got everything you want. You don't have to worry about paying your bills. You've got a great show. All you have to do is not touch certain topics. You're going to go with that? You're going to obey what they tell you to do? Or you're going to spread truth to your audience?
Right.
You know?
That's definitely a problem for most shows. I'm very lucky that I have no advertisers, so I've escaped that trap. But you're right. That's the very reason I can't have advertisers is exactly what you're talking about.
Well, and here it is that when you had this shot heard around the world to take us back to Wittenberg and bring us into the present of people saying, wait a minute, I don't need a Catholic priest to absolve me of my sins. I don't trust a Catholic priest with my kids. I don't trust a Catholic priest to pray my dead father out of purgatory. All I need is the Bible in my language, and I'm going to go straight to the throne of God by myself. That is revolutionary. It's exactly what it was. The Protestant Reformation, the shot heard around the world, the most dangerous thing that happened to this system of control by religion in 1517. And as a result of this, you had a what is now known as the Counter-Reformation. We had a young Spanish Basque noble named Ignacio López. And he was a prince and was involved in the wars between Spain and France. And Pamplona, in the Battle of Pamplona, his leg was shattered by cannonball. And so his dreams of glory and martial accomplishments were shattered. And as a result, he was devastated. He could no longer be a soldier, but he was extremely focused and dedicated and wanted that life. He pulled himself into contemplation and believed that he had a vision of the Virgin Mary, and took this vision to monks in Montserrat and prostrated himself before what is known as the Black Virgin of Montserrat. Now, again, not to offend our Catholic brothers and sisters, but a lot of this iconography can trace itself back to the worship of Isis and Semiramis. Mm-hmm. When you watch a movie and you see the goddess Columbia come up, she looks like the Statue of Liberty.
Right.
That's the same person, Isis Semiramis, the goddess of wisdom.
Columbia Pictures.
Absolutely. You've got the globe of Universal Pictures, and you've got the goddess of wisdom in Columbia and Columbia Pictures.
In District of Columbia.
Yeah,
it stacks
that's exactly
up.
What that's all about.
Yeah,
it's about worship of the goddess of wisdom and reason. And this goes back to this legend of Nimrod. And this legend was retranslated into Osiris and Isis, of this great rebel that was going to lead people against the oppression of God and build this first great empire. Build the Tower of Babel, reach to the sky, which now, if we consider the this flat Earth paradigm, maybe reach to the top of the dome. Who knows? But we have this legend of this first great, powerful rebel leader who, according to legend, was eventually captured and judged by a son of Noah. It was Shem was the son who was, by legend, captured Nimrod and executed him for apostasy and cut him into pieces as a warning against all future apostates, scatter them on the waters. The legend varies based on who's telling it. Poor Osiris was captured by his brother Set, the evil brother Set. You see the similarities there.
Right.
Set was the bad guy. Versus the previous legend where Shem was the good guy. Now we've reversed the roles. Osiris is the good guy. Set is the evil brother. murdered his brother Osiris, cut him into pieces, and scattered him across the Nile. Well, his dutiful and loyal wife, Semiramis, was the dutiful and loyal wife of Nimrod. Isis was the dutiful and loyal wife of Osiris, tried to put his pieces back together because she really missed her husband. Unfortunately for her, she couldn't find his private parts.
Look out.
I'm not making this up.
Oh, I know.
So the part depends on the legend. One legend says that the fish god Dagon found his parts and brought them to her. Another legend says that she created them herself. The bottom line is we have this queen who had a pregnancy, and she wanted to explain this pregnancy by a miraculous interaction.
Right.
And so this is supposedly what this interaction is. And the result was the birth of a messianic child. For the Nimrod Semiramis connection, that child was Tammuz, who was supposedly a reincarnation of Nimrod. For the Egyptian version, it's Horus. Horus was a reincarnation of his father, Osiris, and he went to avenge himself of his father's murder by battling Set, and there's all kinds of weird things that happen there. Mm-hmm. But this is where all that legend comes from. And so when Ignacio Lopez has this vision of Mary, the Queen of Heaven, you know, we question, is this really Mary, the mother of Jesus, or this is this a different Mary? Is this someone that traces her lineage all the way back to Isis and Semiramis? And right. So this is the vision he had. He retreated into a cave, and hey, much the same way as Muhammad did. And he had visions in the cave, and he came up with spiritual disciplines. He starved himself. He punished himself. He wanted to rid himself of his sins. And he came up with the idea of destroying this fledgling Protestant Reformation on behalf of the Pope and winning back the Holy Land in Jerusalem, also for the Pope. So he was going to start this new movement called the Knights of the Virgin Mary.
Mm-hmm.
And so he brought this, first he acted on this movement. He ended up going to Paris in France to learn Latin so that he could further himself in this endeavor. And he connected with some young men that joined him, Francis Xavier for one, Peter Faber, the fathers of the Jesuit movement. Of course, at this time, it was the Knights of the Virgin Mary. So this is 1534, and so they have these very die-hard religious, pardon me, fanatics that were going to put the papacy back in her seat of world control. This was brought before the Pope, and 6 years later in 1540, the Pope said, hey, you got it, go. We're going to make one change. We're going to take the accent off of Mary, and we're going to put it on Jesus. It's going to be much more palatable that way. And we're going to call you the Society of Jesus. Later, it was a slang term that this new society would be called Jesuits because it's a oh, goodness, what do you call it when you put two words together? It's an amalgam of two words.
Amalgamation.
Yeah, an amalgamation of Jesuita. Are you Jesus-like? And it was meant to be an insult because the Jesuits had become so cutthroat. Oh, my goodness. Go online and read the fourth and final blood oath of the Jesuit order. It will curl your toes.
Right. I wanted to ask you about that. What can you tell us about the Jesuits, not only their oath, but some of the rituals they partake in before they join their order?
We don't know anything firsthand. What we do have is the testimony of ex-Jesuits like Alberto Rivera, who I think he's convincing. Look, it's a personal decision whether or not you look at him and what he said as a whole and said, okay, this guy's believable, where he says that the Jesuit, and by the way, he's not the only source for what goes on in this final vow where you hold a dagger by the blade to your chest, and you also hold a black crucifix, and you make this blood-curdling vow to serve the Pope, to literally rip open the stomachs of women, to use the poison cup, to use the strangulation cord, the point of the poniard, or the leaden ball, to murder, to exploit the confessional, to regicide, to kill kings who aren't following the line in order to bring back the supremacy of the Pope. This is what is reputed to be behind the Jesuit order, the Counter-Reformation.
Makes sense given their background.
And I will tell you, and here's an historical fact that makes you think there might be something to this. The Jesuits go all around the world. They are extremely dedicated to their order, their oath, and to the supremacy of Roman Catholicism. And wouldn't you know it, Greg, that the Jesuits have been kicked out of every single country they've been in. I mean, from the very top, kings and presidents around the world have kicked the Jesuits out. Why? Because they've been implicated in assassinations and subterfuge and treason.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've heard you mention this in previous interviews, and I had a question for you on that. But first, let me just say the time is flying by, and it's totally my fault that we haven't gotten as far as I wanted, and hopefully you wouldn't mind staying a little longer than normally so we could get to everything.
I'm here for you, Greg.
Right on. Thank you. So, okay, well, what I was getting at was what you had just said about the Jesuits being kicked out of every major place. That's exactly what researchers who try to place the Jews at the top of the pyramid cite as a historical pattern, and they'll tell you that it's because they keep getting caught trying to subvert populations from within, exactly what you're saying. So I'm interested in what you think about this idea, because it is quite popular in the alternative realm.
And there's a reason why it's popular. It's put there by these forces that we're talking about. This goes back all the way out to the Crusades. As a result of the Crusades, you had the sovereign military order of, well, they eventually were known as the Templars. And the Templars were a very powerful order of knights that led were at the tip of the spear for the Crusades. They were the poor fellow soldiers of Christ of the Temple of Solomon. And the Order of Solomon's Temple is another name of the Templars. As a result of what they did in the Holy Land, going through Jerusalem, win Jerusalem back for the Pope, they became exceptionally powerful and rich. They were endorsed by the Catholic Church in 1129. And so they were very, very favored by the papacy. And as a result of their riches, do you know the Templars came up with our modern banking system?
Right.
They are responsible for modern usury, interest-based banking. Not the Jews, the Templars. And as a result of this, with their power, you had concerns amongst some very ambitious kings around the world, and in particular, King Philip IV of France, where he exploited the same accusations against the Jesuits were there against the Templars. And I'll tell you, Greg, this stuff gets creepy because you see this continuity of these secret societies. They're all accused of black magic, demon worship, severe perverse sexual rites, sacrifice in these rites of humans and babies. And so you had these accusations going against the Templars. And as a result, they were strong enough for King Philip to make the case that Pope Clement V disbanded the order. And this was commanded in, it began to take effect in 1307. And it precipitated the events of Black Friday, Friday the 13th, October 13th in 1307, where the leader of the Templars at the time, de Molay, many of his knights were rounded up, tortured for political purposes, political reasons, because they had information and intelligence that was useful to France. It really had very little. You see how this issue of ethics was exploited, morality. Hey, these guys are immoral, but you know what? I'm going to torture them for political secrets. So they were treated very poorly, whether they deserved it or not. The incident was exploited as a result. Many Templars went underground. They realized that, hey, we can never put our names and our faces to our machinations ever again. We need a scapegoat. And since that time, the Jews have been a phenomenal scapegoat, sadly, because so many of them have been willing scapegoats. They have been empowered by these forces. There is a phenomenal book by a Jew, if I can remember it. It's the Rockefellers and the Federal Reserve, their gold standard, something along those lines. And it is a phenomenal tell-all book that explains how the papacy exploited Jews, used them as the front men for banking, and when it was expedient, killed them, burned them at the stake. That's an historical fact, and that's why the Jews were the butt of many Inquisition investigations, is because that began their exploitation. Oh my goodness, let's talk about the Hegelian dialectic and how the Jesuits and Roman Catholicism owned both fascism and communism. Go to the rise of Adolf Hitler. Do you know that Adolf Hitler's, the book that put him on the map, Mein Kampf, did you know it wasn't really written by him? It was written by a Jesuit.
Yeah, I learned that from your book, actually. You refer to Hitler as a Jesuit puppet.
Bernard Stamfel. This is something anyone can look up. Now, he rewrote. He proofread it. Brother, he wrote the darn thing. Adolf Hitler was damn near illiterate, pardon my French. And as a result, Bernard Stamfel wrote Mein Kampf for him. Franz von Papen was a Catholic aristocrat, bankrolled the Third Reich, would never have existed. Oh my goodness, the Pope, Pius XII, Eugenio Pacelli, prior to, I think in the 30s, he was the papal legate, he was the Vatican, London, and Washington, D.C. are sovereign city-states. Their rules are, they have separate rules and laws. They are literally sovereign city-states. Therefore, the Vatican has an ambassador. And Eugenio Pacelli was the papal ambassador to Germany in this critical time. And surprise, surprise, he later becomes Pope Pius XII. He's known among circles because of the Vatican rat lines that helped pull the Nazis out of World War II as the Allies were closing in. As Hitler's Pope, it's the other way around, Greg. Mm-hmm. Hitler was Pacelli's puppet. So Himmler, look at the connections, the Jesuit connections with Himmler. Mm-hmm. Hitler himself is credited as having said, I patterned the SS after the Jesuits because of their loyalty. And then you go to the other side of the coin, communism. These two sides of the Hegelian dialectic talk about fear of porn, to make good people be afraid for their lives. The fascists are coming. The communists are coming. Communism, the idea of communal ownership of property, goes back to Thomas Aquinas, the great Catholic theologian, writing about the communal ownership of property. Well, it took the Jesuits to put this into practice in the reductionist settlements in South America, where they basically enslaved good Indian peoples in South America, in Paraguay and Brazil and Argentina, and bled these poor Indians dry and sent their funds back to Portugal and Spain, good Catholic countries. And they put this communism into practice to the point where they were able to perfect it. And again, we have to rely on an ex-Jesuit insider, Alberto Rivera. But what Alberto Rivera says fits with historically accepted fact. Karl Marx, again, a Jew, picked as a Jew to be the puppet and the face of communism. Where did Karl Marx come from? Where did he go to come up with the tenets of communism? Where did he write the manifesto? Do you know he did it in a private reading room in the British Museum? Why are you going to go in a private reading room in the British Museum to come up with the tenets of communism? He did that, Alberto Rivera says, because they were secretly being spoon-fed to him by the Jesuits who own communism. So you have this Hegelian dialectic of thesis, antithesis, synthesis. So you have people that have rights. Let's just talk about modern America. The Bill of Rights says, for the first time in human history, we're going to do away with feudalism. We're going to allow a middle class, unheard of, to own property and defend it with a weapon. Absolutely unheard of. How do you get those people to give up those rights? Freedom of speech, the ability to own property and defend it with a weapon from whatever threat, your own government if necessary. You get them to give that up by scaring them with Al-Qaeda or ISIS. What self-respecting jihadi would contort the name of his organization so that it would create the acronym ISIS. Are you kidding me? It was so bloody obvious, Greg, that they had to muddy the waters. Oh, it's not ISIS. It's ISIL. It's IS.
Right.
Because it was that obvious that Freemasonic insiders had created ISIS, like they created Al-Qaeda and good Polish Catholics, Zbigniew Brzezinski, Jimmy Carter's handler and national security advisor, who most of us agree in this community created Al-Qaeda. There's a picture that floats around the internet which looks pretty much a lot like Osama bin Laden, whose CIA code name was Tim Osman, standing there with Zbigniew Brzezinski, still alive, Greg, as an advisor to our current president, Barack Obama.
Damn.
So the Jews are, for the most part, a smokescreen that is put up by these Jesuit forces to hide behind, because nothing gets you better. Look, we have to be scientists. Names, places, dates, things you can verify yourself. What gets you to lose your mind any better than mindless racial hatred? It's the Jews. Right. It's the Zionists.
Right.
It gets you to disconnect your brain. Wait a minute. Step back. Look at it. Is there a purpose in the creation of Israel? Yes, to distract you, to create constant chaos, to make you focus on Jerusalem and not Rome. And that's exactly what we have today.
That's interesting, man. You're making some great points. And in your book, the way you say this is, to quote it, the Jesuits have a powerful apparatus. They shield the elite from view behind the Star of David and attack their enemies with the sword of Muhammad. And that's pretty poetic, man. But as far as the Jewish thing goes, this is something that I've had a problem with, or, you know, had a hard time reconciling, because the Rothschilds, from what I understand, built their wealth outside of the Catholic Church. And I read this book called God's Bankers by Gerald Posner, and he talked about some instances where the Vatican was nearly broke and needed to be bailed out by the Rothschilds. Here's a quick quote. He said, "Although the aristocratic Pope Pius was an unrepentant advocate of the medieval view of the Jews as the evil architects of everything from rationalism to Freemasonry to socialism, he reluctantly agreed that only the Rothschilds could keep the church afloat. The new Rothschild loan was 50 million francs, more than $10 million. That was more than the Vatican's entire budget for a year. And two additional loans were soon forthcoming, totaling another 54 million francs. And I don't know if that's true or not. Of course, I haven't. I mean, that's what he says. But to me, that almost sounds like the Rothschilds bought the Vatican.
Yeah, it's actually the other way around, Greg. Rothschild, Rothschild means red shield. What army used to use red shields? The Roman army.
Yeah.
The Rothschilds, the legend goes for the Rothschilds, is that it was at Waterloo that they were given inside information about who was the winner of the Battle of Waterloo. Well, if that's accurate, and Napoleon's downfall was leaked to the Rothschilds, then I got news for you. It's clearly Rome. Because Napoleon Bonaparte was absolutely a puppet of the papacy, a Jesuit-trained Catholic priest named Emmanuel Sias. Abbey Sias, Father Sias, had whispered in Napoleon's ear the entire time to get him to react according to the way the Jesuits wanted him. Do you know that Napoleon actually conquered Rome and imprisoned the Pope? I believe it was Pius VI that he imprisoned. The Jesuits, as a result of their machinations around the world, had upset even Catholic nations to the point where everyone around the world were telling the Pope, listen to me, you better do something about these Jesuits or we're done, and you're done. And as a result, now some people question whether this was done legitimately or not, or was all a show and done underground. The Jesuits were suppressed, and this was in, I believe, a papal bull of 1773. Clement the 13th was about to sign this papal bull, and he was assassinated. He died. Clement the 14th did sign a papal bull, and he is reputed to have died so horribly that his body began to decay before he perished.
Shit.
His tongue began to dry up inside his mouth. His body was so deformed they could not present him in state to Catholic followers.
Good God.
So later you have the suppression of the Jesuits. Jesuits had disappeared. They didn't exist anymore. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. Just like the Templars who carry on the Jesuit name. But the other way around, the Jesuits carry on the Templar tradition. They went underground for a very, very short period of time, 73. Okay. So you had Napoleon in, I believe it was 1798, conquered the papacy, appeared to conquer the Vatican.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He imprisoned Pius VI, who supposedly apparently died 6 weeks later in prison. They very quickly coronated Pius VII. And boy, Pius VII got the message. Greg, Pius VII reinstituted the Jesuit order in 1814. And there's a fascinating letter that I reference between Jefferson and John Adams about how they are very concerned about the reinstitution of the Jesuit order.
Right.
And then they appear to be a victim of their own ideals, their own Enlightenment ideals. Well, hey, look, it's universalism. These are just priests, so we have to keep America open to these guys. They're not priests, they're insurgents. That's where they went wrong. And I firmly believe that Adams, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, and James Monroe paid for their James Monroe and the Monroe Doctrine, tried to stop the spread of these Jesuit priests, and paid for it with their lives. There is no way, Greg, that we should be accepting the coincidence that Adams and Jefferson died on the 4th of July within hours of each other. This is a famous calling card of assassins.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with James Monroe, who died on the 4th of July. Monroe reacted to the secret treaty of Verona, where Russia, Prussia, France, and I want to say Spain swore their allegiance to the papacy, to conquer the world for the papacy. And somehow, supposedly, James Monroe got wind of this and enacted the Monroe Doctrine as a counter, the great chessboard. And as a result, the Jesuits supposedly murdered him.
That's really interesting, because that was one of my questions for you, is how did the Jesuits get such a foothold in early America when the early founders were so on guard and so skeptical of the Jesuit order? But this makes a lot of sense. This is apparently how it's done. You obviously just kill some people.
They weren't. They weren't. Unfortunately, it's entirely possible that George Washington was a puppet of the Jesuits the entire time. We're all familiar with George Washington's connections to Freemasonry. Many apologists, and let me tell your audience, there is nobody that loves this country more than I do. So if I say things that seem un-American, I want you to know I'm trying to out malignant forces. I'm not trying to talk down. I spent 20 years in the military because I love my country. It's important for us to know as Americans who has hijacked this nation, possibly from the very beginning. George Washington was reputed to have a magnificent painting of the Virgin Mary in his home. His best friend was a Jesuit priest by the name of Leonard Neal, and it is well known that George Washington called Leonard Neal to his deathbed. In fact, a Roman Catholic website will tell you that George Washington died a Catholic because he called his best friend, Jesuit priest Leonard Neal, to his bedside.
Hmm.
Oh, my goodness. You go back to who owned Maryland, the colony of Maryland, Lord Baltimore, George Calvert, a devout Roman Catholic, got the toehold there. And the Andrew White was the individual that owned the property that our White House was built on, a devout Roman Catholic. Many people, hey, what is the White House named after? Well, it's named after its color. It's white. No, it's named after devout Roman Catholic Andrew White.
Hmm.
That whole area, this is really creepy, and I just found this out recently. The area was deeded to a Catholic, a sheriff. Look this up, folks, on the internet. He is deed holder number 7. And if you don't have this information, you can't find it, write to me, johnny@johnnycirucci.com, and I will show you the deed holder for the property that our capital was built upon was a guy by the name of Francis White. And on September 23rd of last year, for the first time in American history, a Jesuit pope visited the White House, and his name was Pope Francis. I'm sorry, Francis Pope was the name of the individual. The sheriff of Maryland, Francis Pope, was the original deed holder number 7 in 1614, I think. And we just had a visit where the entire Congress of the United States bowed before Pope Francis, the Jesuit Pope. So, America, who has conquered America from the very beginning? Let's look real quick at Abraham Lincoln.
Right.
Abraham Lincoln. Oh, my goodness. So we had a Catholic priest who went to Abraham Lincoln because he was being framed by a power play amongst Catholic circles. And Charles Chiniki, Reverend Charles Chiniki, who eventually his protest against the Catholic Church made him leave the Catholic Church. This is crazy. Greg, Charles Chiniki, at that time, Father Charles Chiniki, was being framed by Catholic authorities as having had sexual relations with women and so forth. And so he took this to a young lawyer named Abraham Lincoln. Do you know that Abraham Lincoln won Charles Chiniki's case for him in this slander? And as a result, they became fast friends. And as Charles Chiniki left the Catholic Church, he became extremely concerned with the machinations of the Vatican and the Jesuits and the dangers to the Lincoln administration. It eventually got to a point where Abraham Lincoln is quoted as having said, and Charles Chiniki became a very close advisor, quoted Lincoln as saying, the Jesuits are going to kill me, and they're behind the Civil War.
Damn.
Now, we all laugh and say, oh, that's ridiculous. That's ludicrous. Okay, so who killed Abraham Lincoln? It was a lone gunman, right? A lone gunman. Lee Harvey Oswald. No, wait a minute. Different wrong lone gunman. It was John Wilkes Booth, right? He was the only one involved. Oh, there's some other names there. We need to look that up. An entire family named Surratt, S-U-R-R-A-T-T, devout Roman Catholics. In fact, the matron of the family, Mary Surratt, had a boarding house, Greg. You know, I want to know how devout a Roman Catholic she was. She did not allow non-Catholics to become renters in her boarding house.
Damn.
Her son, John Surratt, was in training to be a Catholic priest. He was the co-conspirator. They actually came up with this, the plot, at the Surratt home. I have found evidence that John Wilkes Booth himself was a secret Catholic. And here is the kicker. The supposedly Roman Catholics are hated enemies of Freemasons. The reality is quite the opposite. If Freemasonry ever had its own will, it was long ago destroyed by the Jesuit order, may not ever have had its own will. Today is completely controlled, and some of the greatest examples I give are John Wilkes Booth, who is a quiet and secret Catholic and also a Freemason, a member of Albert Pike's Knights of the Golden Circle. So you have this Catholic Freemason cabal that led into the murder of Abraham Lincoln. And here's the kicker, Greg. We know that Abraham Lincoln was shot by Wilkes Booth. But what we don't know is that there are sources, and I have them cited in my book, that say John Wilkes Booth never died. He never died in the shootout that supposedly killed him.
I've heard that too.
He escaped and went west. One thing that we can say is an historical fact that fits right in with this is that co-conspirator John Surratt emigrated, left the country, and was helped by papal authorities. At some points, he disguised himself or was disguised by papal authorities as a Catholic priest. Do you know at some point he ended up going through Rome? He was there in Rome and then was in Egypt when he was captured and brought back. And John Surratt did survive. His trial was thrown out. So John Surratt, co-conspirator in the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, lived long after his trial. And we have sources that say John Wilkes Booth also survived, which really might tell you that not only are these forces powerful, they're powerful enough to make sure that their assassins, their hitmen, go unpunished.
Right, yeah. Again, no accountability.
This is connected. In 1866, these routes were incredibly clear. The implication that Rome and the papacy was behind the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and according to Lincoln's confidant, Charles Chinnicky, also behind the Civil War. Citizens were so upset that they demanded action from the puppets in Washington, D.C. As a result, they stopped the legation and brought back the ambassador from the Vatican in 1866. From then on until 1984, there was no connection, no political connection between the sovereign city-state of Vatican and the United States of America. There were no ambassadors. You know who changed that? Ronald Wilson Reagan. And you know who whispered in his ear to get it done? A Freemason by the name of Billy Graham.
Damn. So let me ask you a question here, because I've been pretty convinced by guys like Jim Mars that all the presidents who have been killed, Lincoln, Garfield, JFK, were all trying to subvert the currency control of the elite. Is there truth to that or no?
That's a partial truth. The control, the currency control is a critical part, but it's a middle echelon. It's not the top echelon. The upper echelon is the papacy and the Jesuits. The middle echelon is extremely critical. The Federal Reserve was a sickening, treasonous coup carried out by the bankers. But just look at the connections of Knights of Malta in banking, particularly the Bank of America, created by a Knight of Malta. And that will tell you everything you need to know about who really controls the bank. Matter of fact, that also is brought out in that book, The Rockefellers and the Federal Reserve, their gold standard. I've got a copy of that. I'll give you the exact title. But we'll explain how. Oh my goodness, yeah. There's no doubt about it. Had the critical role. Listen, brother, our currency in the United States is a nickel of what it was worth in 1913.
Right.
After that despicable coup of the Federal Reserve, you can very easily get wrapped up in the truth of the coup of the Federal Reserve and lose the puppet masters who are above the Federal Reserve, which is the papacy, because and that's what they want you to do. They want you to get fixated on the symptoms and not the root causes.
Mm-hmm. They want you to stop on the second or third or fourth rung of the pyramid and never really reach that capstone.
And they're safe. And so if there's any uprising, whether it's an information uprising or something more strenuous than that, they're still safe. They can still control from behind the scenes and manufacture or manipulate the uprising. And boy, has that happened. That's the CIA's calling card right there, is to take an uprising, wait till the people are really ticked, and then manipulate it and warp it and make it go in the direction they want it to go. And so they're perfectly safe. Oh, Greg, great example. Okay. Wraps it all up together. You want to fight the machine, right? You want to go out and protest, but you want to do it anonymously. You're out in the protest. You're worried about a little mosquito drone coming in, taking a picture of your face. What do you go put on to cover your face?
That Guy Fawkes mask.
You put on a Guy Fawkes mask, don't you? Well, who's Guy Fawkes? Guy Fawkes is a Jesuit assassin. Guy Fawkes used to be Guido Fawkes, who was part of, remember, the 5th of November in 1605 was an attempt to murder the Protestant king of England, King James I, James the 6th of Scotland, by thoroughly covering the floor of the House of Lords in gunpowder, barrels of gunpowder, and taking out half the House of Lords in order to murder the Protestant king to gain back newly Protestant England for the papacy.
Man.
So how hilarious is it that if you want to go up and make a stand and fight the machine, you're going to put on the face of a Jesuit assassin? Oh, and by the way, what's been known as Guy Fawkes Day has been a protest since that time where an effigy of the Pope was burned, particularly by good English Protestants. It has so been disconnected from its historical accuracy, no one even knows. And would you believe, and again, this is easy for any of the audience to look up, George Washington, who did George Washington answer to? Do you know that George Washington stopped his soldiers from conducting Guy Fawkes Day, which is to burn the Pope in effigy? He actually told his soldiers they needed to be thankful for their help, the papacy was giving them. Kind of tells you who he answered to.
Yeah. Wow, man. This is quite a bit of information. And, you know, it is a different kind of history than we're used to hearing. Of course, we've discussed why that would be. But can you tell us a little bit about the Vatican hierarchy? Because one of the most interesting angles to me is the idea of a black pope, that we all see this schmoozing public figure of a pope and we think is the boss, when really there's a dark and hidden hierarchy behind him that stays in the shadows. How much truth is there to that?
It's completely true. The Black Pope is called the Black Pope. He is the superior general, a military title given to the commander of the Jesuit order. Our current commander, superior general, is a guy by the name of Adolf Nicholas, and good Spanish Jesuit, just like his founder, Ignacio Lopez. And he's called the Black Pope for two reasons. One is a superficial one because of the humble black priestly cassock they wear. But the reality is he's also called the Black Pope because of the frightening level of power that the Black Pope wields. He actually is in control of the Vatican and the papacy. Great example is what happened with Benedict XVI. Now, Benedict XVI was actually in tight with the Jesuits. He helped the Jesuit write Vatican II. But apparently he wasn't close enough. They wanted one of their own. And so they gave Benedict Joseph Ratzinger, who was a Nazi Hitler youth, gave him a deal he couldn't refuse and forced him to step down for the first time in 600 years so that one of their own, Jorge Mario Bergoglio, could step up and we would have a Jesuit pope for the first time in the history of the Holy Roman Empire in the world.
Yeah, that step down was really weird.
It was extremely weird, and I think it's a result of what we're doing right now, Greg. I think that the promulgation of this information has forced these literal Luciferians, they worship Lucifer, the bearer of light and of knowledge. They're all Gnostics, just like the Freemasons. They believe that he is Prometheus, the giver of light and knowledge, who was beat down by the gods for just trying to help with knowledge and information. White is black and black is white. That Jesus, he's the bad guy. Lucifer, he's the good guy. White and black. You see how they're juxtaposed like black squares on a Freemasonic floor.
Fair, man. Well said. And maybe this is a good place to call it. And we definitely went a little bit overboard, but you know, the joys of not being under someone else's schedule means we can do that. And it's not a big deal. And we might come from different philosophies, but at least we can unite around a common enemy. I think that's really all that matters, right?
Amen. Down with the system, brother. And listen, I love you, brother. I'm here for you anytime. If you ever want to revisit, there's so much more material. You ever want to revisit, I'm here for you, brother. I'll gladly move my schedule around and come talk to you again.
Right on. I appreciate that. So yeah, that pretty much does it for us. But before we really call it in, of course, your book is a massive, near 800 pages with all the sources and everything that you have in it. Remind the people where they can get that, hear your show, and keep tabs on what you got going on.
Yes, sir. You can pick it up on Amazon, or you can go directly to my website. It's johnnycirucci.com, johnnycirucci. You can write me at johnny@johnnycirucci.com. The program is Resistance Rising on Blog Talk Radio. All this stuff are buttons and links on my show, but you can go to Blog Talk and search for Resistance Rising. Go to Amazon and search for Illuminati Unmasked. Be right there for you. Contact me. I'm here. I'm very eager and continue to interact with my audience. I crowdsource intelligence, Greg. I love it. Mm-hmm. I have my own flying monkey squad of flying monkeys that go out and dig up. I tell them, what do you look at? You look at somebody's personal beliefs, their religion, their education, whether they're a member of a secret society. And boom, that's everybody in power right there. Dig up the dirt, send it to me, johnny@johnnycirucci.com.
Very cool, man. I do appreciate your time and the work you do. Johnny, keep fighting the good fight out there. All right, man.
Thanks, Greg. Love you, bro.
There it is, guys, and much love to Johnny as well. I actually think I was a bit harsh on him as I re-listened to it in editing. I think I pushed too hard on some of the religion stuff this time around, but nobody's perfect. It's a delicate balance, and I tried to give even the free show an extra half hour because of that. I think it was a good show in the end and a pretty interesting contrast to last week's guest, where the biggest criticisms were a lack of preparedness, arrogance, and no sources to back up some of the wilder claims. And I think Johnny was much better on all of those fronts. I can tell he really cares, you know? He's put the work in, and even with the religious differences, I think he deserves some credit for his work. These are the days I'm happy THC is successful because I like to connect people to a new resource and hopefully facilitate some new attention to a guy that I think deserves it and probably doesn't get as much of it as he should, despite our differences on the importance of the immigration issue or the strength of one's values that don't come from a cemented source or the flat earth. I'm sure we've all heard the Aristotle quote, "It is the mark of an educated mind to be able to entertain a thought without accepting it." I think maybe we should be reiterating that on every show to some extent, but one idea today that I would apply to that is this position that the Jewish families that we know about are just willing scapegoats for the Jesuit puppet masters in the shadows. I don't hear that often, and I thought Johnny pointed out some great arguments, and I'm not sure that I'm sold on it, but I'm definitely looking at it in a different way, and it was fun to listen to, and maybe it's not an either or, you know? Maybe it's not so cut and dry, but for all these differences, I still got a ton of value out of Johnny's work. I hope you did too, and I really do recommend his book. If you liked the first half of this show, sign up for Plus and get the rest of this episode and all the archives going back to the beginning. I've had a lot of recent questions about how Plus works and how to get the new shows and will it work with this device or that one. I sometimes forget that every episode is somebody's first, and I don't spend a whole lot of time explaining that to people. But again, we are working on an iPhone app. The developer thinks we might be in the 30 to 60 day window to start testing it, but he has a full-time job too. There are a lot of easy ways to get the show, and I do have a frequently asked question page on the Plus site, so just read through that if you're even thinking about Plus, because I think the answers for anything you might be unsure about are there, thehighersidechatsplus.com. As for the content in this week's Plus show, Johnny talked about many, many, many Jesuit connections, from how the White House came to be, which emailed Johnny and he will show you the deed, he said. That's pretty amazing. To the secret hierarchy of the Vatican and the Black Pope, Trump's connections to the papacy and his role in the big charade, pedophilia and the Jesuits, the Franklin scandal, Bill Clinton's Jesuit training, Skull and Bones, JFK, the first Catholic president, Johnny's love of film, and where we see these conspiratorial themes and how he interprets them. Insights we can glean from the very limited number of whistleblowers or Swiss Guard members who have made some, albeit minor, revelations. Tom Cruise, Knight of Malta, the setup for World War III, Johnny's position as a flat earth proponent, how this manipulation has evolved, why it's evolved, and how it all leads back to the Jesuits. I do love hearing about that sort of thing. Can the conspiracy be that big? I don't know. And then more of what we know about these shadow families behind the Rothschild-Rockefeller front, the holes in the Obama story and his CIA lineage, the idea that Obama might be a victim of trauma-based mind manipulation due to these lifelong roots, the breakdown of many major players in American government and the Supreme Court having these Jesuit links, major media pundits too, cloning and the strange behavior of animals, as well as what Johnny's heard about some of the twisted human cloning threads, real big right now. But man, we talked about so much. I mean, you heard the first part. He's jumping from thread to thread so fast, so much of it makes sense. He does try to provide sources, especially in that 800-page book we've been mentioning. I can vouch for that too. You did get a little extra free show today, but still, it always gets better the deeper you go, and we covered too much stuff to list. Big thanks again to Johnny for coming on. I could say more about the areas we disagree, but I just think I made it pretty clear in the show, and I don't want these wrap-ups to always just be about that. But I do consider myself kind of a model example of how someone can have solid core principles without the faith, can enjoy a daily drink and a smoke, and also be motivated and a positive asset to society. I just think we shouldn't judge anyone too harshly because a certain component of their life isn't the same as ours. nothing is so absolute. So chill out on a little of that. But I do appreciate the dreamers, visionaries, and psychonauts who are looking forward more than I appreciate those who want to get back to the Constitution or restore traditional American values. I just don't like that kind of thing. I like individuals, and maybe it's the internet age in me, the rebel, but I don't think we have to be attached to these boxes anymore, or these shackles of tradition, usually dressed up in some type of funny traditional hat. You don't need that. And I don't mind all traditions, but I just think we should make our own. Adventure out, try new things, and strive to make this world a human paradise. That idea that many religions put out, that life is about suffering and that's okay because I promise it's going to pay off. I'll take my chances with enjoyment now. And now I will get some emails about being a hedonist and a Satanist and a degenerate who's corralling my listeners right into the filth and degradation of Satan's cauldron. That's okay. I get constant remarks about my marketing images and how dark they are and how that might be an insinuation that this is a show that's trying to get you. But it's not that either. Look, are there Masons in powerful positions of deception that make me skeptical of the whole organization? Fuck yeah, there are. But there are also really enlightening guys like Randall Carlson, who I love. And many guests who have Masonic roots have come here to talk about sacred geometry and symbolism and a lot of really interesting things. And these principles of enlightenment and self-discovery go hand in hand with the concept that Lucifer is this positive liaison between man and enlightenment despite the wishes of a tyrannical overlord. I don't know. I think I like the idea of eating from the tree of knowledge. And I don't think ignorance is bliss. Yet I'm still a good person who wants to save humanity one digital soapbox at a time. Who knows? I guess we'll see how far we get. But that is it for me this week. Your move, Black Pope of the Vatican hierarchy and your Jesuit foot soldiers. Your fucking move.
Oh no, you see, the world isn't random, it's attached to puppet strings, control over everything. The 9 to 5 is trying to steal ya, now don't that job seem silly? Hello, can you hear me? Or should I play back recordings from some spying agency? Wish we were younger and free. I'll be thankful when it's all exposed, the vast conspiracy. There's such a difference between us and the damn rock. It's done.